Irish stew by the riverside. We got out at Sonning and went for a walk round the village. If you stop at Sonning, put up at the Bull behind the church. It is a veritable picture of an old country inn with a green square courtyard in front, where, on seats beneath the trees, the old men gather to gossip over village politics. We roamed about sweet Sonning for an hour or so, and then, it being too late to push on past Reading, we decided to go back to one of the Shiplake Islands and put up there for the night. It was still early when we got settled, and George said that, as we had plenty of time, it would be a splendid opportunity to try a good slap-up supper. He said he would show us what could be done up the river in the way of cooking, and suggested that, with the vegetables and the remains of the cold meat and general odds and ends, we should make an Irish stew. It seemed a fascinating idea. George gathered wood and made a fire, and Harris and I started to peel the potatoes. I should never have thought that peeling potatoes was such an undertaking. The job turned out to be the biggest thing of its kind that I had ever been in. We began cheerfully, one might almost say skittishly, but our light-heartedness was gone by the time the first potato was finished. The more we peeled, the more peel there seemed to be left on. By the time we had got all the peel off and all the eyes out, there was no potato left, at least none worth speaking of. George came and had a look at it. It was about the size of a peanut. He said, "Oh, that won't do. You're wasting them. You must scrape them." So we scraped them, and that was harder work than peeling. They are such an extraordinary shape, potatoes, all bumps and warts and hollows. We worked steadily for 5 and 20 minutes and did 4 potatoes. We said we require the rest of the evening for scraping ourselves. I never saw such a thing as potato scraping for making a fellow a complete mess. It seemed difficult to believe that the potato scrapings in which Harris and I stood, half smothered, could have come off 4 potatoes. George said it was absurd to have only 4 potatoes in an Irish stew. So we washed 6 or so more and put them in the pot without peeling. We also put in a cabbage and about 1/2 peck of peas. George stirred it all up, and then he said that there seemed to be a lot of room to spare. So we overhauled both the hampers and picked out all the odds and ends and the remnants and added them to the stew. There were 1/2 meat pie and a bit of cold boiled chicken left, and we put them in. Then George found 1/2 tin of potted salmon, and he emptied that into the pot. I forget the other ingredients, but I know nothing was wasted. I remember that, towards the end, Montmorency, who had evinced great interest in the proceedings throughout, strolled away with an earnest and thoughtful air, reappearing a few minutes later with a dead water rat in his mouth, which he evidently wished to present as his contribution to the dinner. Whether in a sarcastic spirit or with a genuine desire to assist, I cannot say. We had a discussion in or not. Harris said that he thought it would be all right mixed up with the other things, and that little thing helped. But George thought otherwise. He said he had never heard of water rats in Irish stew, and he would rather be on the safe side and not try experiments. Harris said, "If you never try a new thing, how can you tell what it's like? It's men such as you that hamper the world's progress. Think of the man who first tried German sausage." It was a great success, that Irish stew. I don't think I ever enjoyed a meal more. There was something so fresh and piquant about it. One's palate gets so tired of the boring old things. Here was a dish with a new flavor, with a taste like nothing else on earth. And it was nourishing, too. As George said, there was good stuff in it. The peas and potatoes might have been a bit softer, but we all had good teeth, so that did not matter much. And as for the gravy, it was a poem. A little too rich, perhaps, for a weak stomach, but nutritious.